Bonjour à tous. Good morning. On m'a demandé de faire les présentations en anglais puisque ce sera retransmis en streaming et enregistré. Donc voilà, je vais parler en anglais. My name is Philippe Lagadec. I currently work for NATO in the NATO Communication and Information Agency in the Netherlands. But in fact, I used to be a student in Toulouse 20 years ago, so I'm especially happy to be here today. So today I will show you a presentation about VBA macros and how to analyze and how to detect malicious macros. So all this is purely personal work, so it has nothing to do with my employer. Okay, so first we look more at the red side. So what are malicious macros, what they can do, and some advanced techniques that have been used in the recent months, in the past few months. Then we look at the blue side, so how to analyze malicious macros and how to detect them to protect our systems. So the history of VBA macros is quite old already. It started back in 95 with the first macro virus written for Office 95. And then there were lots of macro virus in the 90s. And in the early years of 2000, the macro viruses almost disappeared. It was not fashionable anymore. So during 10 years, there was almost nothing. And for some reason, in 2014, malware authors started to use malicious macros again. I think especially because it's much easier to write macros than to write exploits, to exploit vulnerabilities. Because Microsoft Office is also becoming more and more protected against exploits. It has a sandbox since 2010. And also, they changed the way users are protected against macros. Because, for example, in 2003, Office 2000, 2003, all the unsigned macros were disabled by default. But then in 2007, they decided to enable them again. The user had to click twice to activate a macro. And the big change happened in Office 2010, when there is only one click to do on the Enable Content button. So that's why I think the macros have been used more and more since Office 2010, because it's much easier to use and to exploit. OK, what can we do with a malicious macro? First, macro can be triggered automatically when we open a document, or when we close a document, or when we click on something in the document. It can read and modify the document, that's usually what normal macros do, but it can do almost everything on the system. It can download files from the internet, it can create files on the local system, it can create executable files, scripts, PowerShell, batch files. It can execute any file or run any system command on the system. It can even call system DLLs. So that is heavily used by malware authors to inject shellcode into other processes. So they even don't need to write something on the disk. They can inject code directly into the memory. A macro can also call any ActiveX object, and that's also used to run malicious code or to obfuscate or to detect if it's being analyzed, etc. And all of these features are not vulnerabilities. They are really Microsoft Office features available since 1997 without any change. So there is no need for an exploit, it's just there. So if you should remember only one thing from this presentation, is that when a user clicks on enable content, it's exactly the same as launching an unknown executable file. So on most systems, we forbid the launching executable files coming from the internet, but we don't do it for macros. So that's why it's so effective. So for those who have not played with macros, this is to show how simple it is to write malware with a macro. So in these few lines, it's really VBA dropper. So it has everything needed to download a file. So first, if we see here, workbook open will trigger the macro when the Excel file is open, for example. Then it will call the DLL, urlmon.dll, and it will call the function called url download to file A. So this will download a file from the internet, oops, and save it to the local system as an .exe file. And then, using the shell command, it will run it. It's extremely simple, extremely easy to write, and you can write it in thousands of ways. So that's why it's so popular today. So that was the beginning in 2014 when the people started to use macros again. But in the last 3 years, the malware authors have been very, very creative, and they have been using lots of more advanced techniques to hide their code, to make it difficult to analyze, etc. So here I've just made a list of one of the most used things. So for example, in Microsoft Word and Excel, you have a number of well-known triggers. Called document open, workbook open, auto open, and stuff like that. So that's easy to catch, and most people know about them. But recently, a malware author found that, in fact, we can use also ActiveX object to trigger macros. And so that was used to bypass most of the detection that were used before. Another very useful technique for malware authors are document variables. It's a place in a Word document where we can store any data, text or binary, and it's invisible from the user interface in Word, and you can only access it from VBA code. So, for example, there is a tool, open source tool called VBAD, which is used for penetration testing. And it creates a macro which is encrypted, and the key is stored as a document variable. So, which means that you can only find the key by running that macro in Word. There is no tool, as far as I know, that is able to extract this data. And recently, I also made a proof of concept because in a document variable, you can store up to 60K of binary data. So you can store an executable file fully in a document variable that no tool can see. So it's very naughty. Another technique that I've seen a few times, it's an ActiveX object called a script control. With this kind of object, you can write VBScript or JavaScript in it, and then run it directly. So you don't need to write a file on the system. So it means that you can have a VBA macro, which will do some kind of decryption, and then send that payload to the script control and run it. So it's very useful for malware authors to hide their code. I will not go into details in everything. You can also use VBA forms to hide data. Some malware authors have used less known formats, so not Word or Excel, but you have a Microsoft Publisher that can also run macros. And it's, I think, installed with a basic version of Microsoft Office. You can use MHT, which is a multi MIME HTML file. XML, etc. And very fashionable these days is to run PowerShell script from VBA macro. Okay, so this is for this was for the red side. Okay, so now we need to see how we can analyze these malicious macros. So 3 years ago, I started to work on a tool called OLE VBA. So it's open source, published on the internet. So it's a Python script that is able to parse documents, Word, from Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Publisher, etc. It will extract the text of the VBA macros, the code. Then it will detect a number of suspicious keywords that are used by malware, similar as the ones I showed you before. It will detect auto-executable macros. It uses a number of deobfuscation techniques. For example, it will detect text encoded in hexadecimal in base 64 in a reverse order, etc. And it will extract all the various indicators that we can that are useful for analysis, like IP addresses, URLs, email addresses, etc. Okay. You have other tools that are a bit similar, like OLEDump from Didier Stevens and Office Mail Scanner. Okay, so this is just an example of how to run OLEVBA. So you see at the top, it's the text from a malicious macro, the code, and it's quite obfuscated. And at the end, you see in the table all the things that OLEVBA has found in the macro. So in yellow, we see, for example, we have auto-open and workbook open, which show that the macro runs automatically. We have a shell, which is a keyword used to run an executable file or a system command. And at the bottom, you see some IOCs. For example, there is an executable file name. There is a URL to this to download an executable file name, executable file, sorry, etc. So this is to show all the obvious keywords that are of interest for analysis. So that's when you run OLEVBA from the command line. But you can also use it from your own Python application. So there is an API that you can use to extract macros, to analyze them, etc. And this tool has been used by many projects. So just to name a few, for example, the Viper framework, Remnux, the Linux distribution for reverse engineering malware, Hybrid Analysis, which is an online analysis service, etc. Even VirusTotal, I think, uses OLEVBA. It's not obvious, but the results they provide show that it's very close to OLEVBA. Okay. Any question about OLEVBA so far? No. I mean, yes. Sorry, can you repeat? I don't. Okay. In fact, OLEVBA is not for detection. Sorry. Yeah, the question is, are there false positives when we use this tool? In fact, OLEVBA is not meant for detection. It's purely made for analysis. So when you use OLEVBA, normally you already know that this file is suspicious. Okay? It's more for malware analysts. So I will show you another tool later, which is called MacroRaptor, which is more for detection. So there will be some time for questions afterwards. I will continue. Another project I started after OLEVBA is Viper Monkey. So in practice, we see that macros have become more and more obfuscated. So it's very difficult to understand what a macro does nowadays. So we need other approaches to be able to understand what a macro does. So there are various approaches. First, you can use sandboxing or detonation. So using tools such as the Cuckoo Sandbox, or you can use online services like hybrid malware analysis, or malware.com, etc. So this works quite well, but it's just observing what Microsoft Word or Excel does when opening a document. The issue is that these sandboxes are detectable, and many VBA macros are able to detect that they run in such a sandbox, and then they will not do their they will not run their payload in that case. So it's not working all the time. Okay. Another technique used by some people is to take the VBA code and convert it to VB script, and then run it in using the C script interpreter on the Windows command line. First, this is quite risky because you run malicious code. And second, it usually doesn't work very well because VB script does not have all the features of VBA. So it will not run the same way as in Microsoft Word or Excel. Another technique that I tried myself is to write a dedicated VBA parser and to convert the VBA code into a model, and then to do some symbolic execution of that code. So that's the project that I call the Viper Monkey. So compared to OlivVBA, what it does is it uses PyParsing, which is with a specific grammar to parse the VBA code, convert it into Python objects, and then it will trace the code line by line, simulating the VBA engine. And then when something interesting happens, like calling a function, a DLL with a string, then we extract these actions and the parameters. And then we can extract indicators if possible. So that's just an example to show you. So on the top, you can see the parsing. So it has found a few subroutines and functions. And then it will trace the VBA code and find specific actions. So, for example, it will extract, so it will see that it downloads a file from a URL, that it writes a file, an executable file on the system, and then it will display a message and execute a command, etc. So it helps to extract what the macro does. So I will show you a quick demo if it works. Yes, that's the one. Okay, so here I will, oops, I need to show it on the screen otherwise. Yes. So maybe it's a bit too small. I should have tested it before. Oops, sorry. Okay, so I will run Viper Monkey on the. On a malicious file, which is a Word document, yes. Okay, so it will take some time because it's quite slow. But so we see that it's parsing the all the VBA code. This macro is quite nasty because it's heavily obfuscated. In fact, the code is split in hundreds of small functions. And to understand what it does, you need to go through all these hundreds of functions. So analyzing manually this kind of macros is almost impossible. So that's why we need some automation like this. So here it's very verbose because I just put it in a debug mode to show you that it does a lot of things. So it's really parsing a lot of things, and hopefully at some point it should work. Yes, so now it's executing the code. Yes, okay, so the execution is finished, and you see that in fact all this obfuscated code only does that. It will call a method, which in fact, if you read the argument, it's in fact a JavaScript code. So then you get all the JavaScript payload, which was obfuscated in the VBA code. So that's to show in which cases it's useful to have this kind of tool. Okay. Other people have also tried different techniques to do the same thing with other approaches. So for example, there is the lazy office analyzer. In fact, this tool is also written in Python. It will run Word or Excel using a debugger in the background to trace all the VBA related activity. Another one which is more recent, so there was a project called VBA Dynamic Hook, published by the ESET company. And Joy Sandbox, the online sandbox, also used the same technique. In fact, they extract the VBA code, they change the code to insert some hooks for interesting function calls in the VBA code itself. And then it runs the modified code in Word and gets the output. So it will log all the activities instead of performing them. So these two things are quite effective, but not all the time. So in practice, you need to try different tools because not each technique has flaws and will not work 100% of the time. Okay, so we have seen the analysis side. Now we are going to look at detection. Okay, so what if we could detect all these malicious macros and block them before they reach end users? Okay, we have antivirus engines on the desktop, on email gateways, etc. But in practice, we see that they won't help, simply because there are too many new macros every day. It's very easy to write a macro, as I showed you, and it's extremely easy to change the code in a thousand ways. So it's impossible for antivirus engines to have signatures for every single macro. They will simply explode. So what antivirus vendors do most of the time, they want to catch executable files that are dropped by macros, but they will not catch the macros themselves. So that's why most macros go through antivirus engines and they are not stopped. And even if antivirus engines add signature for a macro, the next day they will have to start all over again because it will be a different one. So the time it takes to create a signature and to deploy it to all customers, it's already too late. The malware authors have moved on to a new payload. And if you look today, if you test even malicious macros that are several months old, they will not be detected by your antivirus engine. Okay, so that's why I developed a third tool, which I called Macro Raptor. In fact, I made a few observations. First, all malicious macros need to start automatically. Otherwise, they don't run. So it means that they need to use either auto-open, document-close, etc. There is a small list of function names that they need to use to run. Then they need to drop a payload on the system, either as a file, or they need to inject code somewhere into a process. And third, they need to execute that payload. So we are lucky because all these actions cannot be obfuscated. These are core keywords of the VBA language, and they cannot be obfuscated in VBA. So there is a small number of keywords that need to be present in every malicious macro. And if you look at most normal macros, they do not use all these features at once. Some will start automatically, some will write a file, and some may execute some files, but usually they don't do everything. So using that, it's possible to detect most malicious macros just by checking for a small number of keywords. So the algorithm that I use in Macro Raptor is the following. First, I check for a number of automatic triggers. which is called A. Then I check for any write operation that may use to drop a payload in a file or in memory. That's W. And then I look for any execution operation. And then the algorithm is, so I look for macros which do automatic trigger and either write or execute. And in practice, this algorithm is very simple, but it detects almost 100% of the samples that I tested so far. And there are very few false positives. The only false positives I got today are very large, let's say, commercial macros that do a lot of activity on the system, and it's not the kind of macro that you'd want to download and run on your system anyway. Okay, quick demo, just to show you that it's very quick. So I run a macro raptor on a number of, on a dozen of files. So you see it's much, much faster than ViperMonkey that I showed you before, because it's just detecting small keywords. It's just three regular expressions. And you see on this, oh, sorry, I didn't show you. I'll do it again. And then we're close to the end. Where is my mouse? Okay. Okay, so I run the macro raptor. So you see it's extremely fast. I checked almost 20 macros in 1 second, and you can see that it has identified all the malicious macros as suspicious, and all the files that I put with normal macros are not detected. And yeah, I tested it on hundreds of samples, and it's very, very effective. Okay, so a few applications. I developed a milter script that can be integrated with SendMail and PostFix. So it's able to detect malicious macros in all email attachments that go through the email server and remove them. And another guy wrote also macro milter, which is quite similar. So these tools are available on the internet. And someone also developed a simple GUI for end users. So if a user receives the file and is not sure, it can just test the file, and it will tell the user if it's malicious or not. A recent solution that I've seen is called Malicious Macrobot. So it's a bit similar. It tries to detect malicious macros, and for that it uses machine learning, random forest, to classify macros that are malicious or innocuous. I have not tested it yet because it's very recent, but the difference between that and MacroRaptor is that it requires a large data set of known good and bad macros, and you need time to train the model and check it. So in the future I will try to see which solution is the most accurate. And last but not least, Microsoft has also released some GPOs that you can apply to a domain in order to restrict Microsoft Office 2016 and 13 to block all the macros that are coming from the internet. So it's very basic but very effective protection. Okay, conclusion. Yes, VBA macros are old, but they are still very, very effective to deliver malware. It's very cheap and very simple to use, much cheaper and simpler than exploits, and that's why it's successful. And I see also lots of pen testers using macros a lot, and it works, it just works. So unless Microsoft changes Microsoft Office, it will still be working for the coming years. VBA code can be analyzed with various tools that I showed you, and also online services. But what people don't do yet is to prevent macro-based attacks by detecting and blocking them using filters. So yeah, we need to develop more of this kind of tools, such as MacroRaptor, to be able to block malicious macros before they enter the systems. Voilà. So I think maybe we have a couple of minutes for questions. And I forgot to mention that all these projects are open source. So it's and I'm doing that all on my personal time, my free time. So it's not advancing very fast. So I'm always very happy when people contribute to the projects. And there are already a lot of contributors that have helped me in the last few years. Yes, one question.
Generally, after looking, thank you first for working on this difficult and old subject. What do you think globally of macro languages from the point of view of security?
The macro language?
Yeah. Are they useful or they are dangerous or should they be banned?
I think it's really a bad decision from Microsoft to have kept this language since 90. I think it's there since 97, actually, the current language. And it has not changed much. So it's really something that is 20 years old, and they have not changed it at all. The Visual Basic Editor is still the same. So Microsoft Office has evolved a lot in the last few years, but the language and the engine is still the same. And the issue is that it gives access to everything on the system. It's not like Adobe Reader, for example. If you open a PDF and it has JavaScript in it, that JavaScript is constrained. It can only do some specific things related to the document. It cannot access the system. Whereas Microsoft Office, as I said, if you run VBA code, it's like running an executable. It can do everything. So it's really bad from a security point of view.
It's not only Microsoft, I think. We had also Lotus Notes in the old days with macro problems. We have the Apple script. We had JavaScript. It seems all macro languages have this tendency to open everything on the computer. For users, ease of use. So of course, with ease of use comes problems.
Sorry, I didn't catch the question. Maybe in French?
C'est pas spécifique à Microsoft. Tous les langages de macro depuis les années 80 sont toujours aussi faciles à utiliser et faciles à exploiter. Donc ma question, c'est un peu, comment on peut se sortir de ce problème de l'automatisation dans les documents?
Okay. So I will answer in English. I think yes, macro languages in general are pose security issues, but some vendors do it better than others. So if you look at things like Adobe Reader, for example, it's very well constrained. And today, it's very difficult for people to write malicious JavaScript running in PDF. They cannot do anything useful. Microsoft really did a bad job with VBA. And it's much worse than any other macro language, because you can run DLLs, you can run ActiveX objects, etc. So it's opening everything. So it's all or nothing. You run a macro or not. There is no in between. So they could have secured the system. They could have restricted what the macro can do, but they didn't. And worse, they have, I mean, in the 2000, Office 2003 and 2000, I think even, the protection was much better because users could not run any macro if it was not signed. So it was very effective. And I don't know why, since Office 2007 and especially 2010, they have opened up the UI, and then users can run these macros with one click. So I think Microsoft could have avoided this, but they didn't.
OK, so let's thank the speaker again.